First of all, I'm delighted to be here. Equality, inclusion has been one of my passions since I was very little. For the obvious reason, I look a bit different to most people in reference to companies. And it's really, really mattered to me ever since I was a child. And I'll go through some of the reasons why, many of which you've heard, but maybe I'll try and personalise it and contextualise it a bit for you. I know today you talked a lot as well about technology and AI, and I'll talk a bit about that. Because we are moving, firstly, on technology and massively changing times. When I was thinking about what you were all going to hear today, I was thinking, but it's always been changing. And we should just embrace the changes. And I was thinking back over my career, when I became an accountant, we only just started having laptops. We didn't really use them very much. I mean, most of the jobs I did, probably as a trainee accountant, were in existence 10 years. And my grandkids weren't even on site, but most of what I did was. And that's just the way it's going to be. And I remember then thinking, okay, so it's going to keep changing, and we've got to just adapt. And I thought, you know, some of the stats I was looking at said that in 1995, only 18 million people across the world had internet access. Okay? By 2005, it was 938 million. And today, in the last year, it was 4.1 billion. And there's now 4.7 billion mobile phone devices. When I became a chief exec, we didn't even have data, we just had mobile 10 years ago. We didn't have social media, we didn't have anything. We had 60,000 staff, and our communication skills were by mobile only. Now, you look to all of their ways. But you can still create successful businesses and futures through that change. You just have to accept it's going to be there. I heard earlier on we talked about millennials, and I'm a mum of two millennials, good grief, that's hard work. But our best form of communication between the four of us is actually our WhatsApp group. You know, that's just the easiest way to get my two to do anything, quite frankly. And you know, that's just the way you adapt, because what was WhatsApp not very long ago? And I think, you know, communications tool, all things we're going to do are going to be really, really interesting over the next 10 years. And data, let's just talk a bit about data. How much data do we all have? Too much data. We can talk a lot about analytical data. But for me, it's about the instinctive judgments you make about what you're going to do. You can have all the data and answers in the world. There are just a few things that are right and wrong. And now I'm going to come on to what's right and wrong about diversity and inclusion. And we talked, I heard earlier today, inclusion, it matters. Well, we all know it matters, but nobody does anything about it. We talk about it, we analyse it, we know about it, we write about it, the FT does all those articles about it. But who is really, really, really inclusive in the workplace? When I did my race in the workplace review last year, I remember thinking, I get race. Come on, Ruby, you grew up here, you're Asian, you really understand race. I was the first Asian kid at school. I know it's changed in 30 years. Not according to the roundtables I ran. Everyone's really clear. If you're a BME individual in the UK, there has been racist behaviour against you at every stage of your career. If you're a woman in the workplace, it's likely you've seen substantial bias. If you're different in any way, and by the way, there's so many differences I've lost count, but someone is going to be biased against you, and that's where we are. So we're not inclusive, and we should remember that inclusion is a bit of a journey. And it starts actually by just accepting what our own biases are. And our own biases, by the way, are all there. I love having fun. That means I probably only want to hire fun people. Not quite the case, actually. But you know, what is fun? What is driven, passionate people that want to know this? We all have different views on everything we do. And we know, though, the best teams are widely diverse teams, but if not, they get on, they're teams. And I think one of the big things we're missing on diversity and inclusion is the big view on teams and teamwork and how together we've got to make our organisations more inclusive. You know, we talked about women. Okay, so 25% of the FTSE 100 are finally got more execs who are female. Well, that's fantastic, but what about the exec pipeline, which is going backwards at every level? And it's going backwards for a variety of reasons, not by the way all because of bias, but because of some of the barriers we've got in the workplace. When you want to be a mum, when you want to have flex, there are barriers at every level of your career. There were for me, there will be for everybody. And I think we should just accept that we're not going to change it overnight, but we've just got to keep working on it. And I think if I was to ask everyone just a couple of us on race and on women in particular, two things I know a fair bit about. I don't about all the other areas, actually, and they've all got to be included, whether it's disability, whatever the differences are in the workplace, they've got to be dealt with. But actually, I've got a couple of very simple asks on those two. The first is around sponsorship. and sponsoring three people would fundamentally differ. If every person just sponsored three people through their organisation, and that's different to mentoring, that's actually saying, I will make a commitment to support that individual through their careers. And I'll ask you, well, what have you sponsored? I got sponsored. We all don't realise we got sponsored to do what we do. So if you've got a job, someone sponsored you. And it's around saying, I'm going to do something a bit different with three people that I think have got great potential, and I'm going to do something with them. And actually, it doesn't matter who you are, I think we can all do that. I chair the Women's Business Council. We talked a lot about sponsorship. We're launching a programme on Men's Agents of Change in a couple of weeks. It's the same on race. Race is about sponsorship as well. It's around just, you know, I had two great chief execs that have supported me through my career, one great chair. That's what got me to do what I did. And God, it was hard, but they really, really helped me. I didn't get here because I was just unusually good at what I did. I got here with huge amounts of help. And I think that's a big message in the workplace for everybody. But, you know, we can all do it, and we can also influence our supply chains to do it. So on supply chains, you all have companies you work with. Do they do blind, you know, do they actually have diverse shortlists, or do you all have diverse shortlists when you hire? Talk about it. Do you really have them? Do you stop a recruitment because you haven't had a diverse shortlist? Have you made your point? One of the most amazing messages I've heard in the last year has been from Marvin Reese, who's the mayor of Bristol. He said to me, really, organisations have amazing policies, they don't really do anything. Because if you've never worked with anyone black, you're not really going to do anything about that. You're going to be scared. Who's going to be a bit more ballsy? Who's going to work with girls like me who are quite driven and a bit feisty? You know, it's not for everybody. And I think for me, it's really simple messaging on sponsorship and supporting individuals that are a little bit different, because difference is actually good. And actually, different is great and exciting to have around. But I would really focus on those areas on D&I. I think it's going to keep changing. Tech's going to change. The workplace is going to change. Everything's going to change. But if we're really serious, then for me it's about doing a few simple things. And I know we've got the gender pay gap reporting. Lots of news. They're all going to report at the last minute. No one's going to be very happy with what they've done. But what is going to change because they reported? Is anything really going to change? What, they want to get better? Do they even understand the reasons why? Maybe, maybe not. When I did my race review, we wrote to the FTSE 100 and said, how many people do you employ and at what level? And across the FTSE, there are a handful of people that earned above 60,000 a year that were not white middle class in the FTSE. That's it. I go to a major business meeting of business leaders in the UK. It's a tad elitist and a tad very similar. And that's got to shift. But that's not going to shift quickly. But that's one of the reasons I'm so naturally obsessed with saying, can we just have some aspirational targets? Because it starts a debate that it has on women. It's not helped sort of set a pipeline yet, but it's going to start to help us. We need to do it on race too. We need to do it on all the areas. If you're genuinely passionate about inclusion, then you do it on the areas you're passionate about. And every organisation is going to have a different view on it. And they should do what works for them. But someone out there has got to say, no, come on, we're going to put targets on this. And on my front point of my roundtables is, everyone I spoke to said to me, Ruby, if we don't have targets, we won't do it. Not quotas, targets. Aspirational, you may not even meet them, but at least you've actually put a line in the sand. And I think putting a line in the sand in all this is really, really important. And so, as we move forward, okay, technology is changing, the world's changing, we're all changing, we're all a bit different. Politics is changing, I observe. And I also observe that I think when the top 1% in the world own half the world's wealth, there's going to be a lot more change to governments and politics as we go on. And what matters to me, I think, as we go forward, is business models will need to adapt to change that. They need to be more flexible around the communities they serve, around the people they employ, around share ownership structures, around giving more of the wealth to those that actually create it. And I see that as really exciting. I think there's some huge excitement coming with different things you can do with employees. Because how best to make an employee feel included, but by giving them some share ownership capability. That takes away so much of the angst for anyone I know who said, you know, they feel really proud of being part of something, they've got a stake in something, they're believed in, it stops all the uncertainty about how they look or where they're from. And I think those sorts of models could be really interesting for organisations to live with that. And I think finally, I would just say, there are so many great things we could all do. If please, please, please focus on two or three that you can make some real change through. Data's great, but don't drown, please, don't drown yourselves in data. I've tried it, it don't really get a lot done. What you've got to do is decide on two or three things you're really going to use. And diversity inclusion won't just always matter, it's going to matter even more and more. The best performing organisations, ultimately, are those that are going to be respected by their customers. And customers' buying power, ultimately, will go towards those whose products or whose services they really respect in the long term. And the more diverse you are, I think, the more inclusive you are, the more exciting you are, and I think great teamwork creates all that. I think that's better for business overall. Thank you.